Introduction to the Basics of Dynamo. It's a course about the plugin of Dynamo. It's the Parametric Design plugin for Revit. So in this course introduction, we'll talk about what Parametric Design is, how Dynamo works with Revit, and how it can be used for your projects, as well as a couple examples for what makes Parametric Design a special opportunity for you. Initially, when we think about Dynamo, if it's your first time, you might not know its connection. But if you know Revit, you know the power that Revit has for architecture, sort of producing it. So in this course, we're going to be looking at some Dynamo examples. We'll be looking at different functionality and plugins and how Dynamo pretty much fits in that, as well as an analysis and anatomy of a Dynamo graph, basics of parametric design, which we'll go into a little more about the design methodology, as well as key concepts for successful Dynamo projects. So just sit back, take some notes for what will give you an introduction how to use this and why it's important. Basically, there's a lot of Dynamo projects that are really valuable, and they go in terms from big, large-scale massings, and they work with different Revit functionality. They work with the design process, maybe interior design, maybe a systematic or structural design, and they allow you to do a lot of very intricate things. And it's not, of course, just the architecture. It could be different systems. It could be different elements. It could be numerical. It could be formal as well. So the idea about Revit, which is central to understanding things like Dynamo, is understanding how it's basically this program that's meant to really accelerate the building information model. So you're having this architecture or different systems for a design that's in 3D. It's going to be typically working around the clock, and it works based on each project with its inbuilt functionality. Right? That's everything that was built by the initial developers. However, as those things are going back and forth, you know, you sort of limit it a little bit, you know, per project. You know, you're limited to some of the functions, though they might be great. You know, there's a calculation, there's a system that you really can't enter into. And that's where Dynamo comes in. Dynamo is a plugin for Revit that's now built in. However, it's still something that you have to sort of open separately, build what are called scripts or graphs, and you have to play those. And those now can be integrating both with your project and with Revit. So looking at that, now let's look at what a Dynamo graph is. So that's your base point for creating things in Dynamo. These graphs are going to be connected with the libraries in Dynamo. That's sort of where your functionality comes from. And in the functionality are nodes, nodes made for different types of elements, for creating geometry, work with Revit, work with input, working with things like list, also system functions as well. Now, the graphs are where you're going to have your input for your, as a coder or Dynamo programmer, you're going to be making your algorithms that are going to be composed of those nodes, as well as code blocks where you're figuring out different ways to solve problems with Dynamo and Dynamo solutions. And so the end result is either you're creating packages or you're finding other packages as well, but your pretty much your final script is going to be called and working like a package. You open it and you can run it on your model. That's how Dynamo graphs work. And let's look at the information to find out on how parametric design works. Parametric design is very popular nowadays as a term, but a lot of people don't know what it is. So let's go into that. So for the basics part, there's going to be a logic of design. There's going to be systematic complexity. There's going to be inputs and outputs, algorithms and a code basis, as well as data structures and parametric controls. All of this going together will be connected with integrated design so that you can actually take some of the insights that you're doing with this parametrically driven system and make it into whether it's a one system, an entire building, a furniture, or even just calculations. So that's going to be what we're going to talk about, so you have an introduction and knowledge for how to use parametric design. On the basic of the logic of design, we'll look at this example of this building structure by Jarke Ingels and his firm Big. And what the idea that is behind most of design is solving problems. It could be small problems, it could be big problems. It could be using something like architecture, which solves a lot of problems, but finding the way that you break it down into individual elements. So each design can be broken down and rationalized. And that's something that gives us a key in for where we're going with parametric design. These types of design elements are including form, function, geometry, organization, aesthetics, and many more. So pretty much logic is saying that design is already a process that, you know, there's an A and a B. And, you know, you're getting from point A to point B. You can get from point A to point D or A to Z. It depends on which problem you're solving. In terms of systematic complexity, we are thinking about what can be thought of within the world and what can be created. We initially, as designers, are pretty much dealing with simple problems for the most part, or we get to a point of simplification. However, as we look at some of these examples, you will see different systems that are in nature that obviously solve problems, but they're maybe more biologically engineered, or maybe it's a natural system, maybe it's a mechanical system, maybe, you know, like the laws of our universe are governing those. However, those are typically offset. That's a really important trigger for parametric design. Essentially, traditional design is limited to those simple forms. Complex systems can be understood maybe with math, like we see the algorithm for a sunflower seed. We'll need calculation, however, to figure that out and maybe to create it. Things like growth, expansion, change, and diversity require advanced solvers. You know, we're not just going to be, even for engineers, figuring these out just on the go. And that sort of provides an opportunity for something like parametric design, which is going to use some of the codes and algorithms that we'll look into next. So here is the algorithm and code basis. Essentially, this is actually a little diagram for a little code that was generative with a few small sets of rules. And as it gets larger, it solves bigger and bigger challenges. Essentially, a algorithm is a process or set of rules that can be followed in calculations or other problem-solving operations, especially by a computer. Simple mathematical rules can derive complex value on scale based on these types of ideas with an algorithm. We also have the ability to work with integration and arrangement of code to handle any problem given the time and capacity. That means that we can solve any problem almost and to some extent. So that's how we can even be thinking about something as complex as architecture being solved, because of how we can break things down, and we can make different mathematical rules and organize them. Here's a way to look at things like input and output. Essentially, we need this for algorithms to work, you know, like a function, like maybe a sine function, or, you know, this function is x plus b or something. You have to put something in to get something out. And an architecture obviously has a lot of outputs that you could sort of call sort of how that was created. However, the idea is for code, each code will generally begin with an in process as well as a out process. So that's data that goes in, that comes out, and it's processing it in between. Also, generative code, which is code that will generate multiple options, it should have adequate level of input and output for integration. Also, we can have garbage in and garbage out as a helpful concept to help us simplify our code ambition. That means we'll avoid just putting a million things in if we only are trying to get out a particular type of output. So that's going to help us with working with code. Dynamo and other scripting programs are always benefited by efficiency. Here are some data structures as a concept that's really going to help in parametric design and design with Dynamo. Essentially, the clarity of data's organization improves its utility. That means the more we can understand a unit, like a particular structural unit on a facade, that's one piece, the better we can pretty much array it and develop it for this entire system of this facade. That unique element is needing to have a better data organization. So data gathering and list arrays and storage in central ways is very important for algorithmic processing speed. Essentially, if we can organize it well, we can access it, we can process it, we create more algorithm and different types of processes to produce different types of design. For instance, you know, we could have a very clear organization of how the structure works, and the better we have it, how it works, the better we can array it on this surface effectively and solve more problems, saying how do we use that system in that particular way. Efficient passing and processing data and algorithms preserves the fidelity of functions and it integrates to refine their form. Essentially, that means the easier we can get these working by an efficient data structure, the better we're going to be able to create a form that's working and functional. Okay. Here's the key of systematic parametric controls. That's where we link all those ideas for working on code and algorithms into parametric systems. Okay, the first thing we're going to be doing when we get to the level of parametric controls is when we simplify the script's input, also its output, to create effective parametric controls. That means we know what's going in, we know what's going out. Now, this system's robust function, it enables a variety of parametric integrations to form a function. However, these all have to be sort of calculated, right? It's not just maybe it creates the form, maybe we decided to work with that surface, but the different types of systems that are working in there probably had to be created in a parametric way. So the idea is we have figured out how those are connected with parametric integrations. Systematic complexity can be processed and created through parametric design engines. Now that's going to be key. That means that our complexity being solved that we were looking at before, maybe with biomimetic systems like maybe a sunflower seed or maybe how sound waves work, those are now very easily solved when we break them down into algorithm solvers to maybe develop that form or understand it. Then we create those controls at the end. Now let's look at integrated design. Integrated design is where we take the parametric understanding and we start to apply that. That means that we're gonna take a system, like if we have like a shell or a geometric form, we say, hey, look, we wanna add this unique element, this component across the system. We want to work effectively in all these places. So we calculate that and we can put that into the system. As opposed to simple forms or simple functions, parametric controls enables integrating typical design systems with algorithmic problem solving. So that means we could be solving this system en masse without going just to each individual one and make a solution. And it's also very precise because we have a system that's computationally driven. These codes can go very fast and solve very big problems. Parametric design gives us new options for using complexity and better and more comprehensive solutions because of that. We're going to get into the Dynamo and Parametric Design basis as we go through the course. So these are some concepts as you're going to go through that you'll think about how they're going to connect as you're working in a parametric way with Dynamo and Revit projects. First, you want to sketch those out, every input, every output, you want to sketch them and just keep them with you. It's good to have a notebook every time to know sort of where you are with your code. Also, it's good to leave notes and put that in your code as you develop it. It's also very important to break down your code into smaller bits so you can solve each one if there's an issue, if you can, you know, fix that particular algorithm, it will make your whole code a lot better. It's also very important to error correct and compartmentalize. Essentially, that means that's where you're solving your problems in a smaller bit, but it's also, hey, let me break this part off so I can make sure it's working. And that's going to be very useful because obviously when you start dealing with larger codes, it's going to be helpful to figure out the problem so you can make it work fully functionally. You're also going to need to clean up code. That means just coming back and finding out how things can be easier to read. If you're working with multiple people, you need to make it more efficient, and that's going to be what you'll have to be doing. Next, it's very important, and it'll be important for you to integrate your methods for efficiency. That means that everything that you can do, you might not need to do. That means that sometimes you'll have part of your code work with something you do within the base program of Revit. So, you know, code doesn't need always to do everything. In our class, we'll actually design an entire tower. However, again, it's for your efficiency. So the fact is Dynamo is very good at small problems and big problems. So don't ever be limited to have to do everything in Dynamo, but also understand there's a lot you can do. All right, so let's get into Dynamo and get into our first script.